In the mountains of Montana, scientists are studying a rare and elusive animal, a tough type of weasel with a fierce reputation. The Wolverine.
Well, wolverines are a unique part of our natural heritage and just an incredible creature. Some of the things that we've learned that they do just kind of blow your mind. The terrain that they live in, the way that they can travel across snow. Their home ranges are gigantic, nearly 500 square miles for an adult male. That's a vast area for a 30-pound animal.
Wildlife Conservation Society biologist Bob Inman and his team have been tracking wolverines in the greater Yellowstone region for more than 10 years.
Our goal is to conserve wolverines in the lower 48. By about 1920, they were probably wiped out of the lower 48. They used to be down the Rocky Mountains into Colorado and also in the Sierra Nevada in California. By about 1930, it appears that they began making a comeback from Canada down through Montana and Idaho. And currently, the line of where we believe they exist is probably somewhere in Wyoming. Yeah, we're at about 9,000 feet here. It's winter time, you know, 7 months out of the year up here. It can get below freezing at night almost all summer long. These are the conditions where wolverines excel and other animals can't, and so that's where the wolverine can make its living.
Inman and his crew travel by snowmobiles to reach their mountain research site. For novice riders, like our photographer, it can be a real adventure.
Well, I'm stuck again.
Even the pros, like researcher Nicole Walker, were getting stuck on this trip. At the site, they install a platform for remote cameras and collecting DNA. In this harsh environment, it's the best method for finding these elusive animals. The traditional method of capturing and fitting with radio collars is difficult with wolverines.
Each wolverine has its own identifying markings on its chest, like a fingerprint. And so when they present their belly in the photos, we can see which individual it is, hopefully.
This is a technique that's designed to try and help us learn where wolverines are or are not in the lower 48 states, and also whether the population is stable, increasing, or decreasing.
Six, seven, eight.
These alligator clips are set up, and when the wolverine passes by, they'll clip on and pull some hair out, and that hair will contain the roots, and the roots have a much better chance of providing DNA.
With a trail broken through the snow, the ride down the mountain is less eventful. Walker will return in 2 weeks to check the cameras and hair snares. Back in the Wildlife Conservation Society office in the nearby town of Ennis, Inman prepares for new data and reviews photos from last year's cameras.
So we go back to the camera DNA stations about every 2 weeks. We rebate them and retrieve the photographs that have been made and begin looking through them to see if there's a wolverine present. When he first comes on to the run pole, the camera begins working and it's set to take a photograph at certain intervals. And so you end up with a series of photos that show you the markings, hopefully the sex, and even reproductive status of the individual wolverine that's come on to the run pole. And as you click through the series of photos, you can also see which DNA clips have been knocked down and have a sample from that particular individual.
There are believed to be less than 300 wild wolverines in the continental United States. They're threatened now by a warming climate, melting their high-altitude habitat. Already, they need to cover huge distances to survive.
We had one adult male that we monitored for over 7 years, whose territory was the entire Madison Range, everything from the Spanish Peaks down to Hebgen Lake and between the Gallatin and Madison Rivers. He would make that round about once a month and cover about a 700 square mile area.
The current population of wolverines will need to expand to new territory by traveling through mountain valleys in the changing Rocky Mountain West. And that will be a challenge.
Those valley bottoms are primarily private lands at this point, and there's roads down there where wolverines can get hit on the road. There's houses that are being built in these areas, and so it's important that we learn which habitats are most likely to support wolverines moving successfully from one mountain range to another, and that we work with road departments and landowners to put conservation easements on places that need to remain open space in order for animals to move through there.
Most people will never be lucky enough to see a wolverine except in a zoo. But it's important to know that this secretive, incredibly tough creature is alive and well in the Northern Rockies, a barometer of the health of the high mountains. What happens in the icebound watershed above the forests and valleys of the arid West is crucial to the survival of the wolverine and other more common species, including our own